Today we're going to make this 3D printed articulating camera arm. This design is based off the Woby camera jig by Ben Paik of Woby Design. Ben designed this jig to be made out of plywood, but because I'm me, I wanted to try 3D printing one. You can download the STL files and 3D print your own camera arm, which are linked in the description along with Ben's original plans. But without further ado, let's jump into Fusion 360 to see the design process. The Woby jig plans are available as an SVG, which I tried importing into Fusion, but for some reason, Fusion didn't like this file and it didn't recognize any closed shapes. So to get around this, I opened the SVG in Inkscape, deleted some of the extraneous lines, saved the file as a new SVG, and for some reason, Fusion got along with this file just right. If it works, it works, right? I wanted my camera jig to be the same size as the Woby jig, which is made from 1/2-inch plywood. So after scaling the vector to the correct size, I extruded all of the pieces by 1/2 of an inch. Those larger holes are for threaded inserts, but to cut down on hardware and take full advantage of 3D printing as a medium, I decided to 3D print the threads instead of using inserts. If you're using Fusion to add 3D printed threads to your model, just make sure you select the modeled option, or else the threads will only be there for show and they won't actually print. After adding the slots for the camera mount, I wanted to knock down all the edges with a chamfer so that the camera jig would be a bit nicer to hold. Obviously, there are a lot of edges in this model, and it would take forever to select all of them one by one. So I changed the selection filters so that I could only select edges. Then, by window selecting the entire model, I could select every single edge at once. However, this included the edges of the holes and threads, which I did not want to chamfer. So I went back in the timeline to the step right before creating the threads, and then redid this selection. I still had to remove all of the holes from my selection, and I could have done this faster by just re-extruding the pieces without holes, selecting all of the edges, applying the chamfer, and then adding the holes. But you live and you learn, and now you know how to do it faster. These pieces are held together with 5/16-18 button head screws, and the final step before printing was adding countersinks so that these screws would sit flush with the surface. I'll leave a link for these screws in the description, as well as links and quantities for all the materials you need to make this project. One of the trickiest parts of this design was finding the balance between strength and print time. The obvious way to make these pieces as strong as possible would be to print them completely solid, but this would take an exorbitant amount of time and filament. One way to efficiently increase the strength of 3D prints is by increasing the number of perimeters, and I ended up printing these pieces with 6 perimeters and 15% gyroid infill. Gyroid is an awesome infill pattern because it prints quickly, is equally strong in all directions, and you don't need a high infill percentage to get a strong piece. All of these pieces are printed from PETG filament, and the brand I'm using here is made by Duramic. This material is both stronger and more durable than its more common cousin, PLA, and I love the clean look of the white PETG. It took 67.5 hours to print all 20 of these pieces on my Prusa i3 Mark 3S, and I spaced out that printing over the course of 10 days. This doesn't include the print time for the handle and the washers, which we'll talk about later. The Woby camera jig uses washers, and instead of buying them, I decided to print my own washers and add a subtle pop of color to this project. These 80 washers took 2.5 hours to print, bringing the total print time up to an even 70 hours. Now that I had all the pieces printed, well, except for the handle, but we'll get to that one later, I was finally ready to put this thing together. And to do the assembly, I basically followed Ben's video on making the Woby jig. I started with the base plate assembly, and even though these holes aren't threaded, they were a pretty tight fit on the screws, so that's why you'll see me using my driver here. In Ben's original design, a single washer goes between the base plate and this first layer. I made sure to make my 3D printed washers the same thickness as standard 5/16 inch metal washers so that all the thicknesses would work out and my camera jig would mount properly on a 3/4 inch black steel pipe. As you can see here, two washers go between the two inside layers. After a final layer of washers, I was ready to cap off this assembly with a threaded base plate. Just like tightening the lug nuts on a wheel, I torqued each screw a little bit at a time to make sure I was pulling the threaded base plate in evenly. But I must have lost track of how much I torqued that center screw, because as you can see, the base plate broke right around the threads. Now, I know that some of you are skeptical about 3D printed threads, but I thought it was really interesting that the print actually failed through the infill around the threads. The threads themselves were perfectly intact. This told me that, in addition to being more careful about torquing these screws evenly, I should probably print this piece with a higher infill percentage. And that's exactly what I did on the reprint. This piece has 25% infill. Increasing the number of top and bottom layers would probably also help in strengthening the base plate against these types of failures. All right, let's try that again. For this round two, I switched out my impact driver for a drill to minimize the chance of over-torquing the screws. I also set the torque limit pretty conservatively on my drill. With the base plate securely assembled, I was ready to move down the line to the middle plate assembly. After learning that painful lesson with the base plate, getting the middle plate assembled and tightened up was no problem. As I mentioned earlier, the slots in these pieces are there to accept a 1/4-20 bolt for a camera mount. I was super excited to see that everything fit together perfectly, the movement was good, and the camera arm felt really strong. The base plate, however, fit really tight over the 3/4 inch black steel pipe, so I did a bit of filing on the inside. I also sanded down the threads on one end of my steel pipe, since that's where the camera arm kept getting caught. For the camera mount, I used a relatively long 1/4-20 screw in conjunction with a ball mount, so that the camera could tilt all the way forward to do top-down shots. At first, I tried using a shorter screw, but the lens of my camera would hit the side of the L bracket before it reached vertical. This longer screw was necessary to get that full top-down shot. Once the camera was mounted, I tightened the screws until the articulating arm could extend out fully horizontal without sagging. To put the cherry on top of this project, I wanted to design my own version of the handle which locks the camera arm onto the steel pipe. This design was inspired by vintage flywheels, as well as those huge handles you see on submarine hatches and valves. To lean further into that valve handle aesthetic, I printed this handle out of red PLA. The handle slots over a carriage bolt, and I lock this in place with super glue. The nice thing about mounting this camera arm on steel pipes is that you have a huge variety of mounting options. I picked up a 3-foot-long steel pipe and a pipe clamp so I would have lots of flexibility in getting shots from up high to down low. I'm already using this camera arm in my tiny apartment workshop, and I'm so excited to explore all of the angles that I'll now be able to film from. If you purchase the files, I would love to see your 3D printed articulating arm. Please tag me on Instagram and show off your work.